This morning, I want to encourage each and every one of us to open our hearts and our minds. We're going to get a little bit deep today, as well as we're going to really look at some truth. I know a lot of times truth might be forgotten, and there's those sermons and those things that make us feel really good, and those are great, but we do not need to fear the truth. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
We have to know that the truth does set you free. However, I've never read in Scripture where it said that the truth is so fun and tickles. But it's still needed. Let me open up with reading some Scripture. Before I read it, last week we talked about how Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter said, "You are the Messiah." And Jesus complimented Peter and said, "This is awesome because this wasn't revealed to you by man, but it was revealed to you by the Spirit." So I can imagine if I'm Peter, I'm like, heck yeah. That's just what went down. Me and God, we're talking. I get excited. Has anybody ever had a spiritual victory with God only to mess up the next day? Yeah. You're like, "Oh man, I'm doing awesome. This is great," only to fall on your face. Well, this kind of happens with Peter, because this is right after this takes place. It's Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 through 26. It says, "From that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed, and on the third day be raised to life." Peter took him aside, he grabbed Jesus, took him aside, and began to rebuke him. "Never, Lord," he said, "this shall never happen to you." Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. What good will it be for someone to gain the entire world yet forfeit their soul?" Powerful scripture, amen. Let's gander at verse 23. Jesus turned to Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You don't have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Dang. Think about that. He just got done complimenting Peter. And then he tells his disciples, "Hey guys, I'm going to have to be killed, and on the third day I'll raise again." And Peter, who just got done, you know, getting bragged on, said, "Hey, Jesus, come here. I got to talk to you for a minute. Hey, I will be back, guys. Hold on a second. Just me and Jesus are going to talk real quick." Jesus, I don't know if you know this, but that would never happen on my watch. Never. I have spoken. Let me get this straight. I believe Jesus went into the Robert De Niro mode. Talking to me? You must be talking to me. I'm the only one here. Peter, a human, is rebuking Jesus. Now, here's the point. There's a duality to believers. You have to understand that. There's a duality. Just like there's a duality in Jesus. Jesus is man, but he's fully God. But he still has flesh. And no wonder he looks at Peter, who just got done listening to the Spirit, and said, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me." This is what I think. The reason why he's a stumbling block is I think Peter is appealing to Jesus' flesh. Because in Jesus' flesh, when he goes to the Father, he's not really excited in flesh to be crucified and killed. "But not my will be done, your will be done." And so no wonder he looks at Peter and says, "I rebuke you, get behind me, you're a stumbling block to me." Sometimes we want to hear what we want to hear, but it's not what we need. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Has anybody ever called a friend because you got offended and you keep calling the friend so that they can be offended with you until you call that one true friend who says you're the problem? Then you hang up on them? They don't even know what they're talking about. I had a friend just like that. I was really frustrated. I was having a hard time at work when I first started ministry. I couldn't stand it. There was a lot of backbiting and things going on. So I'm calling my friends and saying, man, can you believe what they did? I can't believe what they did. And they're like, man, you should do this, you should do that. And have you also noticed that everybody has an opinion on your problems? Yeah. They always say these ways, if I was you, I would. But you're not me. Well, I called one of these friends and I let him have it, man. I can't believe they're doing this, man. Like this, that, and other. And, you know, I always make it spiritual. Help me pray for them that God takes care of them. And you know what my friend said? He says, man, Travis, I really need to tell you something. I really feel like God's wanting me to tell you something. I'm like, what is it, brother? It's something prophetic. Give it to me. He said, you got a problem with gratitude. Oh. You know, I was like, hello? Yeah, the reason why you're so frustrated is because you're too focused on self. You're seeing what you think is wrong, and you're not seeing what God is doing, which should be your blessing and your focus. My response was, shut up! I hung up on him. Only to let the Spirit begin to go, you know he's right. And it was. I had an issue with gratitude. That I couldn't be grateful for what was happening in front of me. That I was too focused on things of my flesh. And what I thought was wrong. And it spun me in a frenzy. We all need the truth. And in that, that's what Jesus is trying to show Peter at this point. Yes, it is true. You have heard the Spirit. But man, you are concerned with worldly things. And I can't be concerned with that. In fact, let me get extremely bold. If you and I continue to try to find Christ through our flesh, we will always miss him. But we do. We like to keep Jesus right here. We like to keep him right in front of our flesh. And we want him to hook our flesh up, and then we call that spirituality. It cannot happen that way. It has to be a dying of the flesh to be alive in the Spirit. Then Jesus says to his disciples in verse 24, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. I've read this scripture 1,000 times. Really take this visual. Let's say you're there. You're a disciple. Jesus says, if you want to be my disciple, you have to take up your cross and follow me. And so we do. We grab our cross and we're like, where are we going? And here's what I used to think. I used to think I would carry my cross so I could remind everybody, you need to remember Jesus. I'm carrying my cross and you're not. I'm suffering for Jesus. You're not. I found that's not what it is. In fact, let me ask this question. Where's Jesus going with this cross? Think about that. There's only one place he's going with this cross. To the place where flesh is killed. I know right now in our culture, we love wearing crosses on our necklace. I wonder how many times I've worn my cross that is just a place where flesh dies and considered this my spirituality. Let me explain this to you. The cross is a signal of death. Wait a second, Pastor, I wear it because I'm a Christian. Wearing a cross does not prove you're a Christian. In fact, if you wear a cross, it should remind you one thing. That's a place where you need to crucify your flesh. Amen. Just like Jesus did. Yeah. All right, now let me step on some toes. Can I do that?
Yes.
We have this problem between spirit and flesh. We have a hard time deciphering which is which. If you are appealed by your flesh, please don't say that's God. No, but the Lord brought her to me, bro. I just stepped on a bunch of toes right now. Pastor Travis, the Lord brought him to me so I could change him. there goes the rest of the toes. Spirit is the denial of flesh. That's what we have to really focus on. It is at the cross where our flesh must remain. And here's the thing. It's not a one and done thing. I wish it was. In fact, I am a college graduate by the grace of God only. Because I learned in order to get a degree in college, you have to do one thing. You have to learn a certain amount of information for a short time, regurgitate that at test time, and then forget it. Yeah. I took 4 semesters of Latin, and I couldn't tell you a single thing. Passed it, still can't speak a lick of it. And we want that. We want God to do that for us. God, listen, I really want to die to my flesh. So you go to a service and you hear the music and the words and you have this moment with God. And man, it breaks your heart. And you're crying out to God and you're clearly hearing His voice. And He's telling you He loves you and He has a better life for you. And everything's wonderful. And then you get up and you go outside and you get back to flesh.
Amen.
We all do that. We have to get in a practice where we leave our flesh at the cross. And unfortunately, it is a daily act. Daily. I cannot stand it when people who are Christians act out in flesh and call it God. There's a lot of hate in our world. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And unfortunately, a lot of that hate comes from our churches. Because our inability to love people who are different than us. Not here. It's sad that the world continues to focus on hate and division when we are all in the same boat. Yeah, you might not be where I'm from. You might have different skin. You might have different social class. You know, social class, that's a great word, which is made by man. I mean, I don't think God remembers or even sees social class. He does see the poor in spirit. See, God sees 2 things. Those who are His children and know Him as Father, and then those who don't. He doesn't care where you come from. And if you are of Him and His Father, you are His child, then He's going to want to send you to those who don't know Him. Not to tell them they're bad, but to show them the love of Him so that they can come to Him. Getting on my soapbox here, man. There has to be this practice. And like I said, it's a daily thing, and we lose our minds when we do it. Those days you wake up and you look at God and you say, I need my flesh to die today. I need to walk in spirit. And when you walk in spirit, you're not going to be of this world. In fact, let's look at Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 through 26. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious. Okay, here we go. Sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and anything like that. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit, oh, that's love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying one another. Let me read this part again. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. That's hard. It's difficult to crucify the flesh. And I know, man, I've heard this growing up. No, Pastor Travis. The Lord wants to give me the desires of my heart. If your heart is of Him.
Amen.
Man, and how silly that we are in our Christian culture that we spit hate and call it God.
Amen.
I have children of my own, and they are the most beautiful and most respectful and most kind children to other people. But when they get around each other, it's like they're spawns of the enemy, man. I'm like having to jump up in the name of Jesus, be still. And I get the, you can't do nothing. Where's my belt? Oh, it's going down. Yeah, if you kids don't know that, back when I grew up, you don't get timeouts.
Amen.
Yeah, anybody ever get the smack of the belt? Daddy's home. Time to get the books and put them in. My kids, man, I'll be with one of them, and I'll love on them, and I'll give them grace and joy and forgiveness. And I'll tell them I care about them and how wonderful they are. And they'll go, thank you, Daddy. And then they'll go and blast their sibling. And nothing makes me irate than to see that. I just loved you and forgave you and gave you grace, and you fight your siblings. You should love them the way I love you. And then discipline comes. Oh, yes. Discipline comes in my house. Me to my kids, my wife to me. That's how it works. There's time I'm sitting on the end of my bed because my wife has sent me to the room saying, you think about what you've just done. My kids are walking by like, love you, Dad. Miss you. I bet it irates God when we don't love others the way that He loves us and then say we have a right to hate another. Those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. That doesn't mean that we ask the Spirit to keep in step with us. The Spirit will not exist in our flesh. We must deny our flesh and live within the Spirit.
Amen.
That has to be this thing that Peter is learning. Because listen to this. As we put into practice the crucifying of our flesh, something amazing happens. Because I know right now there's many of us that will take our cross and say, I will suffer for you, God. And we begin to be miserable. And we begin to get mad at people who are full of joy. Because if you're truly a Christian, you'd be as miserable as I am. Don't do this, don't do that, be mad, be sad, don't focus, don't have fun, and especially don't laugh in church. Sinner. Has anybody ever met a miserable Christian?
Yes.
Miserable for Christ? Let me explain you something. If you decide to be miserable for Christ, that is just a selfish act. Some of you in this room, and I'm about to get very, very deep. Some of you in this room are still living in your regret. Still living in unforgiveness, not accepting the forgiveness that Christ has for you. Or you may say, Lord, I know you forgive me, but I don't forgive myself. That is a selfish act. Because there comes a point when you put that flesh at a cross, something amazingly and something spiritual happens. And it's a calling from the Spirit of God to rise. Get up. Be of me. But leave that flesh there. Oh no, don't bring that flesh. I don't want your flesh, I want your spirit. And you get up and you go, I'm different.
Amen.
Now that flesh is going to try to come back.
Oh, yeah.
Has anybody ever experienced that? That flesh is always there trying to come back. Let me ask you this. Has anybody ever gone to a retreat and had a spiritual experience? Dude, I love retreats. They're my favorite. In fact, what if I was to tell you right now that we're like Oprah, and if you'll look under your seat, you'll find a trip to Rio Doce. We're all going to Rio Doce, and we're going to pay your wages for a week. We've already contacted your work. This is a joke, by the way, okay? Everybody on Facebook is like, man, I knew we should have gone to church. That's how Oprah does. You get cash and everything. You know at this church, we couldn't give you cash.
No.
Some of you in this room are like, no, don't give me no cash.
Right.
Yeah, you give me cash, you'll never see me again. But if we all went to Rio Doce and for a week all we did was hang out and sit around a campfire and talk about Christ, man, God would move. We wouldn't be distracted. We would fill ourselves with His Spirit, and then we would start making comments like this. I'm totally on fire for God right now. But then we'd have to come back home. And it wouldn't be long before we picked up our flesh again. Started going back through the practices of flesh. And then we'd look at each other and say, man, I wish I could go back to Rio Doce, because apparently that's the only place God lives. No. It's here, right now. We just have to deny flesh. And pick up the Spirit. Notice this. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 13 through 21 says this. If we are out of our mind, as some say. I want to stop right there. Does that not just explain the refuge?
Amen.
If we are out of our mind, as some would say. Which some say that about us. It is for God. If we are in our right minds, then it is for you. This is the most important part. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And He died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for Him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, this is important, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here.
Yes.
All this is from God, who reconciled us to Himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to Himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And He has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making His appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made Him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God.
Amen.
That is so powerful, ladies and gentlemen. So powerful to be the righteousness of God. There might not be many people in your world that would look at you and say, I believe you're the righteousness of God. Some of us in this room, you look in the mirror, you don't see the righteousness of God. You see regret and failure. Some of you have papers that say, in our court of law, that you are a failure. Let me ask you this question. Does it really matter what the world thinks of you and me?
No.
Now, don't take this cheaply. You can't sit there and say, yes, I don't care what the world says about me. God loves me. He does, but He wants you to die to flesh.
Amen.
He wants you to be alive in His Spirit. And there is that point where we have to say, it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And when we do that, I promise you, your world will open up. Oh, you'll start experiencing things that the world doesn't know. Peace that surpasses all understanding. Joy that people don't understand. love that just will come through you, even though you used to be full of hate. And you say, man, how is this possible? It's because it's the Spirit. The Spirit is the thing that gives life. The flesh is the thing that dies. I'm trying to work out now. I might have made some fleshy decisions on my eating habits. Okay, yeah. But you know what I refuse to do? I refuse to watch the scale. Do you know why? Because I know my flesh. If I work out hard for 3 weeks and I go get on a scale, we don't need to use specific numbers. And I get on the scale and I noticed, oh man, I've lost 15 pounds. That is so awesome. Praise God. It won't be long before my flesh will go, you did awesome. Let's go get a calzone. Only to continue to eat that way and find myself in a bad situation. In fact, I don't look at the scale, and here's the reason why. Pastor, how much do you weigh? I don't know. Because if I feel healthy, and I am healthy, and I'm eating better, and I'm sleeping better, do I really care how much I weigh?
Amen.
Pastor, you weigh 400 pounds. I feel good. Because here's the sad thing about it. If I continue to try to look at my spirituality based on my flesh, then I'm missing the mark. Because if I say, well, if it feels good, then it must be good for my spirit. That's not how it works. In fact, it's usually opposite. Think about that. If you're driving down the street, somebody cuts you off, your desire is to have rage. Your flesh is like, get them. But the Spirit says, be still. Relax. And if you have somebody that's riding with you, they're going, man, I'm mad for you. And if you're in the Spirit, your response is, no, praise God for them. I'll be praying for them. What? Why aren't you mad? Because if I get mad, I'll get way mad. I won't just get mad. It'll affect me all day. It'll mess me up. I'll be consumed by my flesh, and it'll take my spirit out, and I don't want that, so leave me alone. You're starting to make me mad, and I don't want to live by flesh. Jesus, just help me right now, Jesus, right now. Praise God. And that's how we need to be with each other. We need to be real with each other. Whenever you come to somebody, I would love that day when Christians are able to walk around the world and people come up and go, hey, how are you doing today? And you're like, oh, no, you need to stay away from me because I'm having a fight with my flesh right now. And me and my spirit and God are kind of having it, and I don't feel real good right now. I don't feel very stable, so why don't you just pray for me over there? People of the world will go, yeah, not a problem, bro, not a problem. That is, he's got problems. But to be able to say, yes, man, this is tough. Because guess what happens? If you're struggling, then let me stand with you. We'll struggle together. And then when you have victory, I'm going to celebrate that victory with you. But we'll know it didn't come from our flesh, but from the Spirit of God only. Then we will become a new creation. We'll be a new people. And those things that used to hurt and bound us, and those that regret and that pain that used to destroy us, it's our spirit that will say, it's no longer you. The world will come and say, I know who you are because I saw what you did. And Jesus will step up and say, that's what they did in their flesh, but they've been made alive in me. And they are my righteousness. Ladies and gentlemen, it is time to rise and to be the righteousness of God. Keep your flesh at the cross and rise in his righteousness. Not our righteousness, not our beauty. The worst thing in the world is when we stand up and go, do you know how awesome I am spiritually? Pretty good. Me and God are really close. Sometimes he'll hit me up and give my advice. That's when you're sick. When your flesh begins to determine your spirituality. So here's my challenge for us this morning, ladies and gentlemen. Tomorrow morning when you get up, may the first words that come out of your mouth is, Lord, keep my flesh at the cross. Help me walk in your spirit today and know that you're the righteousness of God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Let's stand together. Father, we come before you this morning. I just want to thank you so much for your faithfulness. For Father, it is difficult for us to understand the way you understand. But Father, it is because of your grace and your mercy that we can be better. Father, help us, teach us how to die to flesh. And then show us how to rise in spirit. For Father, that's who you desire us to be. Do all you have in mind with us, Father, for we are with you heart and soul. In Jesus' name, everyone said,
Amen.
Rise well.